praying that God does a supernatural paradigm shift in you today. And I'm going to ask you to turn to Romans chapter 12, verse 1, because when we get there, hopefully he'll do that in you. A paradigm is just a way of thinking about things. A paradigm shift occurs when the dominant paradigm is replaced by a new paradigm. By the way you've always thought about something is replaced with a new way of thinking about it. When a true paradigm shift takes place, the old is replaced by the new. The old becomes obsolete, the new becomes normative. You simply never go back to the old way you used to think about that particular thing. Paradigm shifts take place for different reasons. Sometimes it's because we discover something. This is true, for example, in the world of science. It was the 6th century BC when Pythagoras first suggested that the earth was actually a sphere and not flat. People thought he was nuts. Over the years, scientists started to study it, and guess what? They discovered he was right, and it shifted the way we traveled around the world. The invention of fire shifted society. Society was never the same again after fire was discovered. Someone invented a wheel one day, and travel changed forever. Someone invented gunpowder, and warfare was never the same again. In the 1440s, Johann Gutenberg invented movable type, and the printing press came to be, and reading and education and learning and intelligence was never the same again. Someone, I don't even know who it was, invented the microchip a few years ago, and boy, everything's different now, isn't it? There are these seismic shifts when a paradigm shift takes place. When I started at Bentree, not only did I not have an iPhone, I didn't have a cell phone. In my office, there was no email. In fact, I didn't have a computer in my office when I started here at Bentree. We didn't even have a voicemail machine. When you called the church, if you called after hours, it just rang and rang and rang and rang and rang. If you called during the day, my administrative assistant would have taken on a little triplicate thing. Pete, so-and-so called, would have torn it off and put it on my desk. Those were the days, huh? But everything's shifted since then. There's been paradigm shifts. There's been technological advances. And when something shifts, you never go back to the old way. I would encourage you to try to remember the last time you used one of those little someone called you pieces of paper. We just don't use them anymore. We discover something and everything changes. Or maybe we experience something. Something happens to us one day. And as a result, we never look at the world the same way again. The day the Magna Carta was signed, the English monarchy changed forever. But not just the English monarchy, but democracy around the world changed. The voice of the people finally was introduced into the conversation. Things have never been the same. I had an experience like this summer. I had a paradigm shift. It was maybe the defining moment of my summer, and what's really cool, it was actually caught on video, and I want to show it to you. I was at Pine Cove Family Camp. And the last day, they have a carnival, and they have kids do things, and they have moms do things, and they have dads do things. And all the kids and the moms and everyone else had done their thing, and everyone was crowded around. It was time for the dad's thing, and I got chosen. And what we got to do is we got to shot-put frozen chickens. Shot-put frozen chickens. And so I took my first go, and I got that big frozen chicken right here, and everyone's all around watching, and I threw it as far as I could. I was pretty impressed, actually. But then the guy behind me, he took it more like a discus than a shot put. And he kind of went like this, and he threw it out there. And I looked at the judge, and I said, "That's not fair. You didn't tell us we could discus it. I thought we had to shot put it." And the guy said, "Well, I don't care how you do it. Just get it as far as you can." I said, "All right." And so this is what happens next. Please watch.
He's going backwards. Don't lose it in the crowd.
All right. Oh, my gosh.
Injury on the field. That is a disqualification.
The speaker threw everything. It's almost as bad as going.
Yeah, I hit a kid with a frozen chicken. So here was the paradigm shift. The paradigm shift in my mind was, if you're going to throw a frozen chicken, no discus ever again, only shot putting. I will never, ever discus a frozen chicken again. The kid's okay, in case you're worried. He's fine. See, we experience something and it changes the way we do things for the rest of our lives. Sometimes we just have to hear something. We just have to hear something. And we hear it once, and from that moment on, everything is different for the rest of our lives. It's a paradigm shift. This happened to me earlier this year. After my annual physical, I got a phone call from my doctor's office. And the doctor told me, you know, Pete, we're looking at your blood work, and we need to talk about something. And he shared with me that I am now officially pre-diabetic. My glucose level had been kind of increasing a little bit over the years, and I had finally crossed a threshold. And I said, what does pre-diabetic mean? And he says, basically, it's a warning. It means you're not diabetic yet, but if you keep living the way you are, very soon you will be. The way Libby described it to me is, imagine you go to your doctor, and the doctor says to you, on September 1st of this year, you're going to have a heart attack that will kill you unless you do this, this, and this. Chances are you're going to do this, this, and this. Am I right? It's actually an incredible blessed diagnosis because I'm not diabetic and I have time to make the adjustments so I don't become so. Guess what? The stuff that I've told myself for years I needed to do, I started doing. My eating changed. My exercise patterns changed. I had a paradigm shift. My driving motive is, as Libby says, I want to live long enough to see my teenagers raising their teenagers. That's what I want to see. And so everything in my life has changed because of one little phone call. I heard something, and now it's a completely new paradigm for me. I've had so many conversations with people since. And I've shared this with them, and I hear the same thing over and over. You know, I got to get my act together. I got to deal with this. And you know what? They won't until they have a paradigm shift, until something gets their attention. There's paradigm shifts, and when they're true paradigm shifts, the old is replaced with the new, the old becomes obsolete, and the new becomes normative. You never go back to the way it was. There are biblical paradigm shifts. The new covenant is a paradigm shift from the old covenant. One paradigm shift from the blood of animals to the blood of Christ. Listen to Hebrews 9:13. The blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of heifer sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean sanctifies them so that they are outwardly clean. How much more then the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death, so that we may serve the living God. When this paradigm shift takes place, we go from the blood of animals and it's replaced with the blood of Christ. The blood of animals temporarily cleanses us on the outside. The blood of Christ permanently cleanses us on the inside. How many of you have sacrificed an animal lately? No, the old paradigm is out. It's obsolete. The new paradigm is normative. We're never going back. It is now the blood of Christ. We're not going back to the blood of animals. How about from bondage to freedom? Galatians 5:1 says, for freedom Christ has set me free, set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to the yoke of slavery. The old way was slavery. The new way is freedom. When this paradigm shift takes place, slavery is replaced by freedom. So Paul says, if you've engaged and you've embraced this new paradigm of freedom, why in the world would you go back to slavery? It's obsolete. There's a new way of living. In Romans 7:6, from the old way to the new way, this is how Paul says it. But now, by dying to what once bound us, we have been released from the law so that we serve in the new way of the Spirit and not in the old way of the written code. When this paradigm shift takes place, the law is replaced by the Spirit. The old becomes obsolete. The new becomes normative. We are people living according to the Spirit and not according to the law. Paul says, why would you want to go back? It's obsolete. It's done. When a paradigm shift takes place, the old becomes obsolete and the new becomes normative. My prayer is that through hearing what I'm about to say today, a seismic paradigm shift will occur in you. And the shift that I want to talk about today is the way we view the church. The way we view the church. For a paradigm shift to take place, you've got to go from something to something. Okay, so what are we going from? Well, there's a lot of different ways we could tackle this. Let me just use the label, the consumer mentality. The consumer mentality. The consumer mentality says this: the church is a mall. We love malls, don't we? The church is a mall with goods and services designed to make my life more enjoyable. We would never verbalize this, but this is, for many of us, the way we think. When I feel a need for a fix, I'll go to the mall, I'll get what I need, and then I'll leave. The church is a mall. You know what the number one leisure activity in America is today? Shopping. Shopping. When you are looking for a church home, what are you doing? You are shopping for a church home. It's a consumer activity. You know, the church, church leadership, people like me and us, we haven't helped very much. Over the last 20, 30 years, branding, marketing, billboards, all that kind of stuff has driven the consumer mentality. I saw one billboard in town here for a church in our area, and it said, inner, I-N-N-E-R, entertainment. Not entertainment. We're here to entertain you. So come and get entertained. It's a sanctimonious Madison Avenue kind of thinking amongst church leadership that has bred a consumer mentality in our churches. So I'm not blaming anyone. I'm just saying here we are. This is where we're at. We're pitching goods and services, fostering the consumer mentality. And the consumer mentality is manifest in what I call the emergency room mindset. The church is the place to get my needs met. I'll show up, listen, I'll show up when the pain is bad enough, and then I'll leave as soon as the acute agony has passed. And when the pain comes back, I'll be back again. Please hear me. If you're in pain, please come. I'm not saying don't come, but here's what I am saying. After the pain subsides, don't go. Settle in. The consumer mentality is manifest in what might be called the entitlement paradigm. The entitlement paradigm. The entitlement paradigm, you've all seen it. You are here for me. The dominant mindset is someone else will do it. Someone else will take care of it. I just need my needs met. It's the entitlement paradigm. This many times leads to what I call is the edifice complex. Not Oedipus, edifice. That means that we start to think of the church as a building. And so when we talk about church, we talk about where we go. I'm going to church, or I attend this church. I have people all the time, people who have been at Bentry for years and years say, when I go to your church, they say that to me, and I stop them and I say, what do you mean my church? What do you mean when you go to your church? There's everything wrong with that sentence. The church is not somewhere we go. The church is something we are. The consumer mentality results in scores of people consuming what the church has to offer with no intention of ever contributing to her. I had a major paradigm shift about 30 years ago. Might have been longer. It was one of those moments when someone said something and the way I viewed the church shifted forever. My dad was the one who was preaching at the time. And he was preaching out of Acts chapter 1, verse 1. Let me just read it to you. The very beginning of Acts chapter 1, verse 1, it says, in my former book, Theophilus, the person writing is Luke, in my former book, the Gospel of Luke, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. And my dad stopped and preached a whole sermon on that. And he focused in on that little phrase, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do before he was taken up to heaven. And the Gospel of Luke is what Jesus began to do. And then my dad taught us that the book of Acts is what Jesus continued to do after he was taken up to heaven. How did he do that? Well, read Acts 1 and 2. The people of God were filled with the Spirit of Christ came to indwell them, and then they became the body of Christ on earth, and then Jesus continued to do his work through this physical manifestation on earth called the church. And then my dad said this was the paradigm shift. We get to write Act 3. Act 1, Luke. Act 2, Acts. we get to write Act 3 because guess what? The Holy Spirit of Christ is still indwelling the body of Christ today. We are the physical manifestation of Jesus Christ on earth. When he wants to tangibly touch someone, he does it through the church. Here's the paradigm shift. The paradigm shift is from the church is a mall with goods and services designed to make my life more enjoyable to the church is the body of Christ. I am connected and participating. Totally different mindset. I ask you to turn to Romans chapter 12, verse 1. And this is where we see one of the places where Paul uses this imagery to describe the church. He does it in other places as well. And I'm not going to preach this. We don't have time today. But I'm going to read it to you. And I'm just praying that the Holy Spirit uses it to change, supernaturally change the way you view the church. Therefore, okay, I lied. I'm going to preach it. Now, this is one of the most powerful therefores in the whole Bible. Because therefore reminds us to read what he just wrote. And this therefore wants us to go all the way back to Romans chapter 1, verse 1 and read the whole thing. Therefore, Romans 1 through 11. What does Romans 1 through 11 teach? First few chapters talk about sin. The next couple of chapters talk about salvation. The next couple of chapters talk about sanctification. The next couple of chapters talk about sovereignty. It's God's master plan of rescuing a fallen mankind. Therefore, since you've experienced God's grace, now he's going to talk about what living in his grace looks like, okay? So therefore, I urge you, brothers, I beg you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, in view of everything that he's done for you, for us, I urge you to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. What is our response to his grace? To give ourselves fully to him, full surrender. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. J.B. Phillips translates this verse, don't let the world squeeze you into its mold, but let God remold your minds from within. Yes. Let him give you a paradigm shift. Supernaturally, let him do it right now. The word transform there, metamorpho, it's the word from which we get metamorphosis, from a caterpillar to a butterfly. Let him take your mind on the church from a caterpillar to a butterfly. Let him change it forever. Never seen a butterfly go back in the cocoon and come out a caterpillar, have you? Once the old is done, it's obsolete, and the new becomes normative. It's a paradigm shift. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given me, I say to, underline these words, every one of you. Okay, so if you're sitting there right now thinking, boy, I hope so-and-so is listening to this, stop thinking that. The sermon is for you, for me, for every one of us. Do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment. Now, one example of thinking of yourself more highly than you ought is to view the church as a mall with goods and services that are designed to make your life better. Don't do that, he says. In accordance with the measure of faith God has given you, just as each of us, circle each. Each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function. So in Christ, those of us who are true believers, we who are many form one body, and each, circle each member belongs to all, circle all the others. Paul is making a simple point here. We are the physical representation of Christ on earth, and if you are in the body of Christ, you, every single one of you matter. Every single one of us matters. For the body to be the body, every single one of us has to be engaged. You say, well, I don't really know how I fit into the all, Pete. Well, keep reading. Verse 6. We all have different gifts according to the grace that God's given us. We all have different ways to invest, to contribute. If a man or a woman's gift is prophesying, let him use it in proportion to his faith. If it's serving, let him serve. If it's teaching, let him teach. If it's encouraging, let him encourage. If it's contributing to the needs of others, let him give generously. If it's leadership, let him govern diligently. If it's showing mercy, let him do it cheerfully. This is not an exhaustive list. We're not going to dive into the nuance of all these things. Here's what Paul's saying. You're all different. Just like all the parts of the body are different, but every single one is absolutely necessary if the body is going to be what the body's supposed to be. Have you heard of planking? I'm going to plank while I preach. Okay, the reason that this is important, I encourage you to try this when you get home. It doesn't look that hard. When you get home today, try it for 60 seconds. Just see how it goes. Planking requires the entire body to be engaged. Okay? Kind of like the church. Now, if the goal of my body is planking, I have to have my entire body engaged or I'm not going to be able to do it. Can you imagine if during my plank, my right leg were to say, I don't want to plank anymore. I'm just going to take a little time off. I can keep doing this, but it just got considerably harder. And I'm not sure how much longer I'm going to be able to keep doing it. And then my left hand says, I'm done. Planking's boring. My right hand says, I don't want to do this anymore. And also my left elbow says, you know what? Planking is for fools. So my left elbow quits. Okay, so that's hard. It's really hard when the whole body's engaged. Friends, listen. It simply doesn't work when different parts start bailing out. The goal of the church is not planking. Thank goodness. So what is the goal of the church? We're going to be talking more about this fall, but I'm reading through Hebrews this year, and I come across a little portion of a verse that for some reason I'd never seen before. It just jumped off the page at me. The author of Hebrews says, see to it that no one misses the grace of God. I thought, wow, what a charge. I mean, what would the church look like if the whole church took that seriously? If we looked at North Dallas and said, our goal as the church is to see to it that no one misses the grace of God. My friends, if we're going to see to it that no one in North Texas misses the grace of God, all of us have to be engaged. We have to. The paradigm shift has to take place. I see this moment right here as one of the most important moments in the history of our church. Because if all of us can just make this shift, I could see God seeing to it that no one in our area misses the grace of God. How cool would that be? So, what do I want you to do? I'm trying to catch my breath from that plank. I'm exhausted. I'm going to quit preaching now. Yes, 25 minutes early. And I'm going to do it so that you can take a step into this new paradigm. Because after I got that phone call from the doctor, I made a decision in my mind, it's going to be different from now on. And then I woke up the next morning, and guess what? I had to step into that difference, or else the paradigm shift wouldn't have made any difference whatsoever. And not only do I have to step into that difference, I have to continue to live in that difference, day after day after day. Here's what's happened historically at Bent Tree. It's happened recently. We get up here, and we encourage you to sign up to serve, and many of you sign up to serve, and then you don't show up. That doesn't help. Doesn't help you. It's kind of like the right leg saying, I'll do it, and then not doing it. The only way that we as a body can be healthy long term is if we say, yeah, I'm going to think of the church differently. It's not a mall where I go to get goods and services for my own enjoyment. The church is the body of Christ. I am connected. I'm investing in her. I'm a part of this. So that no one misses the grace of God. Please stand with me and pray, and I'm going to give you some instructions. Lord, I can preach a sermon. I could preach a two-hour, three-hour, four-hour sermon. I could be as creative as I possibly can be, but that's not going to change anyone's mind. Only your Spirit can bring about this transformation of our mind. I pray in this very moment, Holy Spirit, supernaturally, you would change the way we view the church for the rest of our lives. Never again would we see it as a mall. That paradigm would become obsolete. And this new paradigm of us being the body and being part of this together so that no one misses the grace of God, this would be normative from now on. Do this in every single one of us, I pray. And I pray it in Jesus' name.